Thank you, Ed. Thank you very much, Ed. It's a privilege and a pleasure to be here tonight among my friends and colleagues and fellow club members. I've been a member of this club off and on for about 9 years now, and I've seen great speakers here, incredible presentations. I never thought I would be invited to speak, so it's an honor to be with you tonight. First of all, I'd like to offer a couple of explanations and apologies and disclaimers. First of all, I'm not a scientist, and I am not an expert. I am not all about all natural beekeeping, because keeping bees in a box is not a natural thing to do anyway. I have no financial interest in any of the companies or products that I may recommend tonight. I don't have any reason to plug them unless I just know from experience that they work. So what I'm going to tell you about is my experiences and my observations and what I've seen in the last 10 years of my pretty intensive indoctrination into honeybees. If I offend anyone, I apologize, because some of the things that I say may not be politically correct, especially if you're a all-natural beekeeper. So I just want to apologize up front. And then lastly, I want to say thank you for coming out and hearing what I have to say, and thanks especially to my home club, Susquehanna Beekeepers, in Harford and Cecil County, just to the north, only 20 miles away, by the way, and all the folks who came out tonight, President Harry Dutcher. Harry, wave your hand there, is president of Susquehanna Beekeepers, and all the other members, Charlie, our vice president of Susquehanna Beekeepers, and other folks that came tonight. Thank you very much, and thanks for the support of Susquehanna Beekeepers. They say that I might be the second biggest beekeeper in Harford County. But if that's true, most of the beekeepers are less than 5'6" and maybe weigh less than 130 pounds. There are some pretty small beekeepers up there. They're not very tall at all. I do have a lot of hives. It ranges, you know, anywhere from 20 to 100. It goes up and down because of the years. I really knew I wanted to keep bees, though, early on when I got started at the very beginning, and I wanted 6 hives, and Lloyd would only sell me 2 because there was not enough bees that year. And so I said, well, gosh, I got to get more bees. And so I went around collecting bees. I made a vacuum and sucked bees out of a building, and I would drive over to Elkton to Silver Gray Apiaries, and a fellow named Ross Adkins, an old gentleman who made queens, and I'd buy queens, and I'd make nukes and splits, and I bought nukes, and I had to have more bees. Does anybody have that problem? Can't get enough bees? It's a disease, isn't it? It seems like it must be a disease, not enough bees. So at some point, you have to have enough bees, and I want to make sure that you get enough bees, and I'm going to explain how you can get more bees by making more bees. Those two hives turned into 12. Those 12 hives, I put them into a horse shed for the winter, and in the springtime, 11 hives, double deep, came out. And I said, man, this is great, and it's so easy, I'm going to get rich. Well, that's about the funniest story that anybody ever heard. The bees then began to teach me some lessons, and some very, very serious lessons. And I have learned a great deal, and I continue to learn. And I thank all the teachers and the people that every time you go to a bee yard with another beekeeper, you learn something new. And I want to say thank you to Nate and the team at the Nuke Yard. that I got to spend some time with a couple of weeks ago, and aren't, I'm sorry?
We were happy.
It was good to be with you and to learn some things from Nate and Arnie and Julia and Kyle. They were my teammates on the nuke yard that day, and it was very enjoyable to be with you all. Some of the great things that you've got in this club include your library. And your library always was an inspiration to me. Some of the greatest books that I've read came out of your club library. So if you haven't gotten any books there, be sure and do that. And early on, I was browsing through the library here at CMBA and found Practical Queen Rearing in the North. It's like, really? Are you sure? And so I read it, and Carl Jurica from Cornell University, Dr. Jurica, explained how you can raise queens in the North, and it can be done. But the really interesting thing, though, is that what Dr. Jurica said in his book was that, in the introduction, is that it takes about 20 years to become a fairly good beekeeper. And so I've been doing this about 10 years, so I'm not even halfway there yet. But he was very interesting. So let's see if I turn this on. Yes.
At this point, you want me to?
It's up to you. It's up to you. Whatever you would like.
Okay, I'm just thinking people might be able to see the slides a little better.
Yeah. Is that better in the back? Is there still enough light? Maybe up just a little
Barely.
Bit for me. I need a little bit more for the videographer. Thank you. Is that okay? And so here's some figures. And the reason why we want to talk about making nukes and splits is because we're losing a lot of bees. How many of you lost some bees this last winter? How many of you lost all of your bees this last winter? A lot of us lost a lot of bees. It kind of depends upon the story you want to hear, though. I can tell you whatever story you want to hear. If you want to hear that bees are on the way out, it's a crisis, then I can tell you that story. That's the upper part of the story. We've lost 36% of our bees on an annual basis every year for the last 8 or 10 years. And we've lost, in the last 7 years, 11 million colonies of bees at a value of about $3 billion. So that's the bad story. If that's the story you want to hear, that's fine. But that's not the real story. The real story is in the lower part there. Between 2002 and 2012, the census of U.S. beehives shows that the number of colonies increased 40%. So how can we be losing bees all the time if we have more bees? And the answer is because we make a lot of bees. We make 1.1 million queens every year in the United States, and we make about 1.2 million pounds of bees that come into packages and are shipped all over the country. Now, if you take those 1.2 million pounds of bees, think of it in terms of 600 Lloyd Snyders driving to Georgia, getting a truckload of bees, 666 packages, and driving back to Oregon Ridge Nature Center to drop them off. That's 600 Lloyd Snyders. That's a lot of bees. And so they make a lot of bees. And how many of you have read the great book by Jay Smith called Better Queens? Bush Farms website. Be sure and go there if you haven't. If you haven't gone there lately, go to the Bush Farms website. Download Better Queens and read it. Jay Smith knew a lot about queens, because making nukes and splits is a lot about queens. It really is. But in that book, he describes the fact that he went to his out to Sunday morning. One Sunday morning, he was supposed to be going to church, and his wife, this is like in 1929, and a swarm came out, and he begged his wife for permission to get the swarm. The swarm weighed like 28 pounds. It's like, he weighed it, you know? And he said, it was huge. So we don't have swarms that big anymore. And so we don't have quite the robust colonies maybe that we did back a long time ago. So the problem before 1990 was too many bees. That was the main problem in our beekeeping business, was we had too many bees. They were always swarming, and so, but now we don't have that problem quite so more. Now we need more bees, and so we're going to talk about how to make more bees by making nucs and splits. So this is my new presentation called Beekeeping 357. And Beekeeping 357 is a story about doing things in threes, fives, and sevens. First of all, in order to be more successful, you need to do the three essentials, which I call controlling varroa mites, requeening, and feeding if required. And on a previous YouTube video where I talked about requeening, someone commented and said, well, the only reason why you want people to requeen is because you're selling queens. And that's not true. I can find a queen if you really need one, but I'm not in the business of selling queens. If I say requeen, it's probably because you probably need to think about requeening. Three more things that you should do is raise your own queens, catch some swarms, and plant bee-friendly trees. And on the right-hand side are some of the things that I'm going to tell you about tonight. The nuke box and why it's a great tool. Why one hive is not good enough. The nukes in Telrekov and Brother Adam's bee nukes. And some other points there. That's kind of the summary of some of the things that I'm going to try to cover. I cannot teach you everything about making nucs in one 50-minute session, but I can give you some pointers where you can go and get more information, and I can give you some really great videos to go watch so that you can become an expert in making splits and nucs. But I can't teach you everything tonight, and I'm not going to try, but I'm going to try to give you some indicators based on my experience of where you can get the encouragement to do it, and all you need is a little bit of encouragement. When I was wanting to jump out of airplanes when I was in the Army, I thought, you know, it'd be great to be a skydiver. So I thought I'll do skydiving. And it scared me to death, though. I kept going back, though, because I wanted to do it so badly. And finally, somebody said, you're having trouble with this, aren't you? I said, yeah, I really am. He said, come with me. So he took me up to 8,000 feet, jumped out with me, held on to me the whole time. You know, and we flew for 30 seconds and opened our parachutes. Everything was okay. He said, you can do this. And that's all you need to make nukes. You just need somebody to take you by the jumpsuit, by the bee suit, and say, we can do this, and I'm going to show you how. So the challenges of one hive beekeeping. It's really hard to keep one hive of bees. You can do it for a year, maybe two, but pretty soon you're going to have a problem. Your queen is going to fail. They're going to swarm. You're going to have some difficulties. So one hive beekeeping, while it sounds good, I only want one hive of bees. Somebody tells me that so often. Yes, I know you only want one hive of bees, but honestly, if you're going to do this successfully, you need to get it up at a little higher level. And I think the answer is about five. People say, well, three. Okay, if you can do three, you can do five. And I'm going to show you why five really works. Five works better than any other number. For a small beekeeper. So the idea of doing more than one came from my article that I wrote in the American Bee Journal called Beekeeping 2.5. You can look it up on the web. Just Google 2.5, Beekeeping 2.5. It explains why you could keep a nuc with two hives and then use that nuc to make queens and keep a spare queen. Some of the other articles that I've written include requeening a drone-laying colony. And my latest article, published this January in January 16 of American Bee Journal, it's a lot about your club and other great clubs. It's called The 52 Most Important People in Your Bee Club in 2016 and why you need to be involved and active and helping to keep your club a great club that it is. So 6 years ago, we invited Dr. Larry Connor to come down to teach a queen rearing class, and Jeff Nelson and Dave Papke and Roger Williams and I and 16 other people spent 3 days with Dr. Connor and learned queen rearing, and it was a great time to be with him. But much of the things many of the things that I'm telling you about are written in Dr. Connor's book Increase Essentials, which is in the library. Second edition is the best one. There's two editions, but try to get Increase Essentials second edition. In the first edition, Dr. Connor mentions, has some pictures of some of my nukes, and then gives credit by saying, these are nukes from a Maryland beekeeper. Anyway, he's a great guy, and I love his book. Just, you can read it over and over again, get something new out of it all the time. So the advantages of keeping more than one hive. When you keep more than one beehive, just like having a bigger bee yard, you can make comparisons from hive to hive very easily. And then if you need to, you can make emergency manipulations and cross-level the strength of your hives. You can raise locally adapted bees and raise your own queens. And of course, the more bees you have, the more economies of scale you can get, because if you get an order over $100, everybody knows that shipping's free from Manlike, and over $150, shipping is free from Walter T. Kelly. And if you go in with your friends, you can certainly get an order for $100, you know? So you go in with your buddies. Don't do it by yourself. You know, you don't always need $100 worth of beekeeping equipment, but you've got a friend who needs some, and you know, just get together. Make sure your club has a purchasing coordinator where you can get together and get free shipping on all your stuff. So there are some disadvantages to keeping more bees, and that is that it takes more time, and eventually you'll get to where your wife will say, what time are you coming home tonight? Because it's always the bees first on the way home from work. It takes more time to manage them, and it costs a lot to feed them. So now I'm going to explain why five hives is the right number. Matthew Libhart is the president of Lancaster County Beekeeper Society, 135-year-old beekeeper society up in Lancaster. And Matt is a mathematician, and he came up with this chart. It explains, using simple binomial probability, that if you lose bees based on the rate, those rates, 10% to 60%, how many bees will you have at the end of these number, at the end of the year? And the answer is that if you have five, there is a almost absolute certainty that you will have a hive of bees that are still alive at the end of your first winter. And I'll show you this. That doesn't show up very well, so I'll show it to you on another chart that's the opposite of this. This is the number of hives you have starting the winter, and the probability of having one hive come spring. This is the same set of information on a binomial distribution basis, and it's the number of hives that you have starting the winter and the probability. You're based on the loss probability. So you see where the break point is? If you were saying, okay, suppose I think I may lose, say, 30% of my hives. If you lose 30% of your hives and you start out with five hives, you're going to have a very high probability that most of your hives are going to be alive. So you see how the numbers work in your favor? Five is the answer. It's just simple statistics. If you follow those numbers, if you have 100% success, that's even better. So let's talk about nukes. Why make nukes? Dewey Caron, he's spoken here at this club in the past, and he's a great resource. And he always talks about resource hives and why make nucleus colonies, because they're resource hives. But there are other reasons why you want to make nukes. Making increase is the term that for making your colony strength bigger. And you may want to make a nuke also because you want to raise a spare queen and keep a spare queen. But the fourth reason you might want to make a nuke is because it's just fun, you know? And how much fun is it, though, sometimes to go into your biggest, strongest colony and try to work it? Not that much fun, is it? But guess what? You can work a nuke, and it's really fun because it's easy. It's not a lot of lifting. There's a good chance the bees are not going to be quite as difficult. So nukes can be a lot of fun. And maybe too much fun. You have to resist the temptation of going in your nuke too often, because that's one of the problems. Is it's so much fun to go look at your bees that you get in the habit of going to the little one instead of the big one, because the big one is just not that much fun anymore. And there's another reason why you make nucs, and that is because nucs are first-year colonies, and everybody knows that you make your honey from a second-year colony. So how do you make lots of honey? By making from second-year colonies? It's by making lots of first-year nucs. That's the answer. So I just gave you the secret to getting rich. There on the left is a photo from Scientific Beekeeping about what a typical nuc might look like. It's a perfectly balanced colony. It's got a little bit of everything in it. Hopefully it's got a nice frame of brood or two. It's got some drawn comb with maybe some pollen, and it's got a frame of honey. And you usually put in a frame of foundation, which I added that little thing at the bottom, say frame of foundation, because they need some place to use all that wax that those hatching bees that are 6 to 12 days old are going to be making from the wax glands, and they need a place to use that, so they need some foundation to draw out. So those are kind of the definitions. When you're making up a nuc, size matters. Bigger's better, in some things that may be not true, but with nucs, size does matter, and so if you can make them a little bigger, more brood is always better. So this is a little bit about the history of nuc making. We've been making nucs for 3,000 years, maybe a lot longer. The Egyptian settlements in what's now Israel, in 3,000 years ago, before in pre-biblical times, before the Israelites came across, were making nucs. And they've just recently, like in 2007, discovered in the archaeological record, Tel Rekov. And Tel Rekov is near the Jordan, River Jordan, and they found evidence of about 230 beehives. And they're all, they were clay and straw about this big around, and they were stacked in three rows, three high, and it was a nuc yard, 3,000-year-old nuc yard. And they were making honey, and guess what? Now we know that from Deuteronomy 31:20, Exodus 3:18, Ezekiel 20:16, the references to the land of milk and honey was about nuc yards where they made honey. It wasn't about something else. It was about bees, and they did the analysis of the bees that they found in the fossil and the record there. And guess what? They're Anatolian bees. They're not the native bees native to that region what's Israel now. They were the bees that are actually native to Turkey. So they were kind of like Carniolans. So the ancient Egyptians and Israelites from 3,000 to 2,000 years ago were raising Carniolans, just like us. At least that's my story, and I'm sticking with it. You can go on BibleWalks.com or Google Tel Rekov and get the rest of the details about the nuc yard at Tel Rekov. It's an interesting story. So nuc boxes come in a lot of different styles. You can buy them commercially from all the different manufacturers, but you don't have to. You can make your own. You can cut a regular tin frame box in half, maybe add a quarter of inch to each side to give it just a little bit of extra space. Or if you cut it down just right, you can make a nice spacey four-frame nuc and a nice spacey five-frame nuc from a 10-frame box. Just add two sides to it. You can make your own design. It's not hard. You can make it out of scrap. You can make it out of plastic signboard. The club in Wellington, New Zealand, has February newsletter has an article about how to take a great big piece of plastic signboard and how to cut it, zip it with cut little sections off of it to make a nuc box out of it, and where to fold it. You can make a nuc box out of anything. It doesn't have to be wood, it doesn't have to be fancy, and you don't have to spend a lot of money for it. It's a temporary hive anyway, just to get you into your tin frame equipment that you're really trying to move to anyway. And with nucs, you can stack them up, You can make little supers on top of them, make miniature hives, so they're two high, three high, and make a 15-frame nuc instead of a 5-frame nuc, but it's stacked up instead of stacked sideways. You can make a regular box and put a divider in it and put multiple nucs in one box. There's all different kinds of ways, and your imagination is your only limit. And all of these things work. I've tried them all. They all work. Some a little bit better than others, and I'll tell you about those. But basically, the nuc is your fourth most important tool in the beekeeping business. The most important tools in the beekeeping business. The veil, the smoker, the hive tool. But number four, the nuc box. And so, beginning in April, if you don't have a nuc box in the back of your car when you go to church, to school, to work, you are wrong. You need, I'll show you some pictures of my truck. It usually has four to six nuc boxes in the back of it. So lots of different ways to do it. You can stack nucs on top of other hives for the winter or stack them straight up. And one fellow in the Bee Journal takes a T-post the metal T-post and drives it in the ground next to his nuc boxes because he keeps stacking them up higher and higher. He has to have something to tie them to because they'll fall over. There's lots of ways to do this. So on the left there is a place where I got into a big hive. It was a couple of years ago. I found queen cells everywhere. I neglected it. It was time. And when you find queen cells, you got to make nucs because they're going to swarm anyway. Right? You're not going to get a honey crop anyway, so may as well make nucs. I made 9 nucs out of that hive and then expanded them as the season went on. If you overwinter 7 nucs, but you lose 3, how many do you still have? 4! So you just make more, so if you lose more, you still have more. There's lots of ways to do it. You can break up a hive by putting all the boxes of your nuc boxes in a circle and let the field bees come back to a single location. You can do walkaway splits where you take the bees and all the field bees and shake them in, put them into the box with the frames and then shake more bees in there. Then close them up nice and tight, seal it off, make sure it has ventilation. In the summer, if it's hot, nucs have to be ventilated because they're very sensitive. And then you can walk it away. You can take it away 2 miles for a few weeks before you bring it back. And of course, you always need a second nuc yard, a place to take your nucs so you can bring them back in a couple of weeks. So you always need a second place or a friend. You need a friend who you can borrow their bee yard. You know somebody who has a bee yard. They keep bees. Your buddy keeps bees. You need to be able to say, hey, I need to bring something over to your yard. Okay, no problem. Come on over. And you can switch your nucs out. Your yard can be his nuc yard. His yard can be your nuc yard. You can just switch back and forth until you get everything leveled out. So for overwintering these nucs, there's basically 3 ways you can overwinter nucs. I call it the stack, the pack, or the rack. You can stack them and make them taller. You can pack them by putting them side by side and putting some insulation around them. I put insulation under them directly on the ground. South facing, protected from the wind. I stack them. Double stacks work really well. And then you can rack them, which means you can put them on top of other large hives. So you can put 2 nucs on top of 1 strong hive and overwinter them like they do farther north. So it's you can stack them, pack them, or rack them. Got to turn it off and back on again. Maybe that's it. Okay. There we go. So I've given you some recipes for how to make nucs. Now there's a lot of different ways to make nucs, and you can find lots of books and references to do it. But I've given you a couple of recipes here. Basically, everything in beekeeping is it depends, right? Every question you ask is it depends. And of course, the new beekeepers they want the answer and they want it right now. Said, just Joe, just tell me what to do. I don't need to know a lot of details. Just tell me what would you do right now? So, what, and I need it quickly, 20 seconds or less because I'm really in a hurry. Well, it's hard because there's so much to consider. And it's the same thing in making nukes. There's a lot to consider, but I'm going to give you some things at the risk of being too simple. Basically, up until May, you can do it. You can get away with almost anything up until right now, maybe for another couple of weeks, until the black locust flow is over. And when the black locust main nectar flow is over, you can no longer get away with doing things wrong. After that, you have to do everything exactly right, or the bees will teach you a lesson. They will kill your queen. They will do things that you say, oh my, I didn't expect that. Well, so you got to be smarter than the bees. And so I've given you the second method, the modified method, and that is when you make a nuke after a certain point, we'll say after the main nectar flow, you've got to force the bees to do what you want to do. And the only way you can do that is by making sure that they have no larva or eggs that are viable, no larva that's over 2 days, that are younger than 2 days, that they can choose to make their own queen from, because they will select their larva to make their queen out of, and they will kill your queen and say, no thank you. So you've got to give them no choice. And the way you do that is by aging the brood. If you want to make a nuke later in the year, later, for say from June forward, you want to make a nuke successfully, and you don't want to lose your queen, expensive queen that you purchased, then you need to age your brood above an excluder. 5 days. No viable larva. Then you pull it off and make your nuke. And then the bees say, oh my gosh, we have nothing to do. We can have nothing to make a queen out of. And you give them a queen, and they say, thank you. And you have success. But do it a different way, and you will learn some tough lessons. So if you want to learn some really great things about nuke making, go to YouTube, look up Landy Simone from Northwest New Jersey Beekeepers Association, and watch her one-hour video on making nukes. It's a great video, and it's all about nukes. It's one of the best that I've seen. That's a picture of Landy on the right there. And then because making a nuke is really a kind of like a story of requeening, you need to know a lot about requeening, because making nukes is really a lot about queens. And so you've got to know a lot about queens, and you've got to learn how to introduce queens. And so you need to spend a few minutes and go to that Vimeo called A Practical Guide to Requeening by Bill Bundy and watch that video. It is one of the greatest explanations of how to requeen. There are very few people who can explain it in such perfect terms as Bill Bundy does in that video. He's from Northern Virginia. And yes, sir?
Do you have any preference for using the cage or the queen cell as far as
that's right? I prefer queen cells. I like queen cells, and right now I've got, sometimes I order queen cells. If I don't have time to make them myself, but if I find queen cells, I'll make lots of nukes using those queen cells. And you? Yes.
You put in the cage wrong, or it just doesn't take if they for some reason go too long without having a queen.
Absolutely.
Decide not to have one.
Nate's absolutely right. It's fun to catch virgin queens, and there are different kinds of situations with bees, because different species act a little differently. Russians like to carry a lot of queen cells, and they like to make a lot of queens. How many people keep Russians? You probably have noticed that they really do like to keep a lot of queen cells, and they make a lot of queens. And so it's fun to go in there and catch virgin queens that are being held captive. Most people don't even know that virgin queens can be held captive by the bees until they are ready to be released. But I caught a couple of nights ago, and I put them in cages, getting ready to put them into nucleus colonies, and they were sitting on my desk at work, and they were piping, and I thought, oh, that's kind of fun. Maybe I should record them so that everybody could hear them. So Let me see if I can play. I embedded it into the video, and then that Mac didn't want to play my audio. So I'll see if you can hear this. Those are piping queens.
And that's in the queen cell?
They were actually in a queen cage. They had just hatched. That pitch is C above middle C. Now, really, you remember that pitch. When you hear it in your bee yard, you will know that there are queens in their cells piping or already released that are running across the comb. And sometimes when you pull a frame and it has a virgin queen on it, she will run across the comb piping as she goes. And if the bees are quiet and they're not making a lot of noise, you can actually hear her piping as she runs across the comb, and you can say, "Oh, virgin queen." And you can just reach down and pick her up and put her in the cage that you're carrying in your pocket. What? Why are you laughing? You carry cages in your pocket, don't you? Well, here, pass these out. These are, pass those up and down the rows there. Let's get some started. These are JZ, BZ queen cages. If you go to the bee yard and you don't have queen cages in your pocket, you are being irresponsible. Sir?
Can you hear that with standing on the outside of the colony with
yes.
the lid on it?
Yes. Sometimes, you can hear the piping going on. If you walk past your row of beehives and you hear that noise, it's like, well, I've got new queens. They're talking to me. Anyway, it's a lot of fun to catch virgin queens and to use virgin queens as, and if you find, I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in just a minute. But so successful nuke making is a lot about successful requeening. This is really important. Do you know why you always buy Classico tomato sauce? Because you need feeder jars with 70 millimeter lids, single piece lids. You don't buy them. You get them at the grocery store. You tell your wife, do not buy anything except spaghetti sauce that comes in a jar that can be used as a feeder jar with a single with a lid. Otherwise, you pay 70 cents for that lid from a man like. You don't want to do that. Anyway, and a 70 millimeter or 2 3/4 inch hole saw is the only little tool you need on your drill to drill a hole in the top of that nuke lid to make yourself a feeder hole to feed your bees, to feed those nukes. And it's simple. You know, anybody can do it, and it doesn't cost much at all. So you can find ways to make your apiary sustainable year after year just by using available equipment and cheap things that you can repurpose. Repurposing, I love repurposing. So this is a queen calendar. How many of you have ever seen a queen calendar circle? Here we go. Start this around. You can take a look. That's a queen calendar circle. It's a wheel, and the wheel turns. And so when you go into your beehive and you see a queen cell larva, and you look in the larva, and it's you know how big it is, and you know that the queen the open queen cell is only open for 3 days. And you look in there and say, oh, that's about a 2-day-old larva. You take the wheel, you spin it to the size of larva that you have today, and then you go across the other side and say, oh, let's see, today's the 3rd of May. So let's see now, she's going to hatch on the 10th of May, and I'm going to harvest her on the 9th. So I'm going to make a nuke on the 6th. So that I can make put the queen in on the 9th because she's going to hatch, the queen cell is going to hatch on the 10th. Like, this is why you need a queen calendar. And everybody needs one. Yes?
So you make the nuke
At least one day. I prefer a few hours is good enough sometimes, but the right thing to do is at least 24 hours. Two or three days is okay. The problem is that if you wait too long, and they've got larvae that they can make into queen cells, they will go ahead and start making their own queen cells, so you don't want to wait too long. So the sooner, kind of a day is about right, but you can calculate when am I going to make the nuc, how long am I going to age it, and then when am I going to put that queen cell in based on your thing. Go to the Susquehanna Beekeepers website. There's two Susquehanna Beekeepers clubs, by the way, one in northern Pennsylvania, one in northern Maryland. We're the one in northern Maryland. Go to our website, download the calendar wheel, print it out on your color printer at work, and I didn't say that. And then tack it together with a little staple, and then keep it in your car, your pickup truck, so that when you see something in the bee yard, you can spin that wheel and say, "Oh, I know when she's going to hatch," and you will have incredible information. Or if you decide you want to graft, and you graft your own queen, then you'll know exactly when to harvest the queen cells based on your grafting. I got that queen wheel. We got it from Better Bee, who got it from Lyson in Poland, and it wasn't copyrighted, so we just made a copy of it to share with everybody. And so now you can have one too. So some important nucleus making considerations. A nucleus colony is a small colony, so it's susceptible. It is delicate. It needs your consideration. It needs your attention. It needs your careful thoughtfulness about where you're going to put it, because guess what? It is more susceptible to heat and cold. So I would never put a nuc in the sun. Keep it in the shade. You've got to protect it from heat and cold. It can't be too cold. In the last few weeks, we've had some pretty cold nights. And so it's tough to have a really small nuc. The more bees you have in a bigger nuc, the more chances there are that they're going to keep the temperature right, especially if they're incubating that brood. A nuc is susceptible to pests. If you make the nuc too small, small hive beetle could take advantage of it and take over. It happens, it can be a devastating thing when the small hive beetle takes over your nuc. So it needs to be strong enough to protect from pests. You need enough field bees and enough nurse bees to kind of balance the operation, so you can still send out some foragers and still take care of the brood. So more bees is better. For a nuc, I recommend do not check them too often after you make a nuc, but once a week is probably that's a lot, but it's probably okay. But don't check them every day, because that's going to hurt them. That's going to be a problem. A nucleus colony is going to be more vulnerable to robbing. So if you've got a really big hive nearby and a nucleus colony, there's a chance that the big hive could rob it out, especially later in the year after the nectar flow is over. That's when you have to watch out, because your big hives will suck those nucs dry and kill all those bees. So you might want to have a nuc yard. A friend of mine, Jane and Drew, volunteered to let our treasurer, our last treasurer of our club, John Kovac, bring his bees up to their house while he was moving into a new house across the street. He was going to move a few hundred yards. He knew that the right thing to do was to move the bees up the road for a couple of miles before he brought them back to his house, which was only a few hundred yards away. So he brought them up to their bee yard, and their hives were weak. His hives were strong. They robbed out Jane and Drew's bees, and Jane and Drew said, "What happened? You know, we were trying to be nice, and your bees took advantage of us." Anyway, so you have to be careful to protect your nucs from robbing. They need to be fed. It's always good to feed your nucs, or make sure they have plenty of honey. A frame of honey is kind of the minimum, but it's not essential. So if you don't have honey or nectar, it's still okay. You can still make a nuc. Just give them a jar of sugar water and feed them. And the question of, do I make nucs in deep frames or medium frames? Medium frame boxes or deep frame boxes? And the answer is yes. Make them in whatever you got, you know, and stack them up higher. If you make them in mediums and you try to overwinter them, probably three stack is probably more appropriate. If you do five frames and they're deeps, probably you can do two. You can get by with one, but two's better. And so it doesn't make any difference if you're doing mediums or deeps. Just do more of the mediums when you do them. How late can you make nukes in the year? And the answer is, well, it depends. But basically, I would never make a nuke probably after July. It's just too hard and too dangerous. It can be done if you have enough assets. But interesting, in general terms, you could, April and May are the best times. June is okay. Stick with May and June, and you'll be okay. If you go later, you're going to have some problems. But the later you start a split or a nuke, the more assets you need in it. And Jeremy Rose, who's the author of a new book called Beekeeping in Coastal California, a very interesting book, he says in May, June, and July, making splits, you should use 3 frames, 5 frames, or 7 frames of brood to make your split, to make sure it's big enough to get the population that you need to get through the winter. So it's kind of easy to remember beekeeping 357 and making splits in May, June, and July using 3 frames, 5 frames, or 7 frames of brood. And it's easy to remember. And it's every place is different, but basically you won't go wrong if you use that formula. How many of you have sperm gauges on your queen? It's on the right there. E is empty, F is full, and your queen is either full or empty or somewhere in between, right? Well, why don't we? We don't know how much sperm she has left. So everybody keeps a spare queen, right? Well, you keep a spare tire in your car, don't you, Charlie? Well, how about insurance? Do you have insurance on your car?
So long.
Well, and the reason is because you might have an accident. Okay. Well, your queen might run out of sperm. You need queen insurance. And guess what? That's your nuke. That's because you've got a spare queen. That's your insurance. And so after you have insurance, you can drive confidently down the road knowing I have a spare queen. No problem. So get some spare queens, and you'll have your insurance. Because she is going to run out. Where to put your nuke? In the winter, I'd put it in a protected place where it gets reflected heat. In the summer, that's not the place to be because it's going to be too hot and it's going to burn up in that same spot. But ask yourself, where does the snow melt first around your house? That might be a good place to put those nukes for the winter. Think about it. In colonial Pennsylvania in the 1600s, observers said that they saw skep colonies, bee colonies, on the south side of all the houses in Pennsylvania. Well, it's a perfect place. They didn't stay there all the time. They moved them later on. They were skeps, and they were portable nukes that could be moved. And they weren't there all summer. They were only there for the winter. A little bit about Brother Adam from Buckfast Abbey. Brother Adam was very successful. He developed the Buckfast bee. That's probably the main thing you know about him. But the interesting thing is that Brother Adam had a secret that not many people know right now, and that is he kept, for his 2,000 production colonies, he maintained about 2,000 nukes. And why did he do that? He did it because he wanted spare queens to requeen the production colony. So what he did was, it was a really fascinating and innovative method that he developed. In the spring, in March, he would take the queens 40 at a time out of the nucleus colonies in his nuke yards, take them directly to the production colonies, take out the production queen, put in the nuke queen, take the production queen out of the production colony, go back and put it in the nucleus colony. This is in March. And then the production colony had an 8-month-old queen to produce honey. Then he waited 3 months until June, July, at which time he requeened the nuc and made a new queen for the nuc by killing the old queen, putting in a queen cell, and he made a fresh queen in his nucleus colonies that would overwinter, and then he would use it again in his production colonies every year. Using this system, he produced 158 pounds of honey per hive in thousands of colonies. It was pretty amazing. But nobody talks about that system now, but it could work for us as well by making queens in nucs. On his second trip abroad, by the way, he was collecting various species of bees. On his second trip abroad, he tried to bring African bees back to England, but they died, so they did not get introduced. Maybe it was a good thing. A little bit about Michael Palmer and Michael Bush, two great guys that are into nuc making. And in Vermont, Michael Palmer makes bee bombs. His nucs, he calls them bee bombs, and they explode in the springtime. Sometimes he takes a hive and he splits it into as many nucs as possible. It's called palmerizing. When you palmerize it, you just make it into as many nucs as possible. Be sure and go to the YouTube and look up Michael Palmer and watch his presentation at the National Honey Board. Great presentation, and you'll be very impressed. Now, who knows about Randy Oliver, scientific beekeeping? Everybody knows scientific beekeeping, but you probably don't know that he runs Golden West apiaries, and he runs 1,200 colonies of bees. He runs them into almonds, and as soon as he comes out of almonds, what do you think he does with those 1,200 colonies? He splits each one into 5 nucs. Nobody knows that, except if you listen to some podcasts where he's interviewed, and he reveals his secret. 5 nucs out of every hive. He intends to be able to be successful with about 4 of them. And we could do that too. We can make nucs out of our colonies. So this is a little bit about some of my bees building up. Bees do build sideways. Bees do build down, but they also build up. And during a nectar flow, they'll go up pretty quickly. In Canada, they use nuc boxes that are polystyrene. They'll take all their beehives and bring them down to 5-frame nucs and put 1,000 colonies on a truck, ship them south to the U.S.-Canadian border where they overwinter, and then back north in the springtime and put them back into 10-frame equipment. They have to, because guess how many packages come from Georgia into Canada every year? 0. No packages come from Georgia. The border is closed. So the Canadians have to figure out how to make nucs and keep bees. So what do you do if you find some nice, big, fat queen cells? And the answer is make nucs. Use JZBZ queen cells, queen cages, if you find virgin queens that are about to hatch. And the secret, did everybody look at those JZBZ cages? Okay. On the blunt end, look at the blunt end. See the blunt end there? Okay, not the tube end, but the blunt end of a JZBZ cage. There's a little bar there on the end. That's the breakout bar. Nobody knows about the breakout bar, but I talked to the guy who makes JZBZ cages, who's the manufacturer and owner of JZBZ, at the convention back 10 years ago, and he said, I invented this cage just for you beekeepers, and you're not using this capability, but it's not talked about anywhere. So what you do is you break out the breakout bar and let the nurse bees come and go. Queens still can't get out. You can spend a lot of money for a fancy queen introduction system, or you can just buy a cheap JZBZ cage and use the breakout bar, but nobody even knows it's there. Anyway, so look at those and be sure and see the breakout bar on the end of the cage. By the way, if you find some queen cells and there's a little circle around the bottom of the queen cell, look really closely. If there's a circle, you can see a different coloration. The queen may be trying to get out, and she's being held as a virgin captive. And so every time she eats her way out a little bit, the bees will feed her through the hole and then seal it up again. And you'll see a ring around the bottom of the queen cell, and you'll say, oh, she's being held captive. Or maybe she's not. Take your finger or something and just pick on the bottom of the queen cell just a little bit, and if it flips open, if the flap opens up and then closes again, you say, oh, she's not even in there. She's gone. Because sometimes you can't tell. Because when she eats her way out, she's pushing against the bottom. And as she pushes her way out, that cap opens. And then as she leaves, it closes. And you can look at it and say, oh, there's a queen in there. But there may not be. So check to make sure you're not looking at something that you think it's something that it's not.
One time I found a dead worker inside a cap queen cell. Apparently she had gone in to clean it.
And got capped. Amazing. You see the darndest things. And you learn something every time you go into to the bees, don't you? So this is so sometimes those queen cells stick down too far, and so you need to reposition them. If you're going to make a nuc and you're going to put a queen cell in a nuc, and you need to reposition those cells so that when you take that frame and you set it into your nuc box, you don't punch the bottom of the cell, right? Okay, to damage that cell. So one of the things you can do is reposition it to somewhere on the frame. And so what you can do is you take your finger and you just press into a nice place where there's nothing there except a bunch of empty cells, and make yourself a place to position the queen cells. And then you reposition the queen cells and then put it into your nuc box with another frame of brood, honey, pollen, and you've got a nuc. And in a few days, those queens will hatch, go out, get mated, come back, and you've got a nuc colony that's on its way. Yes, sir? I had too many, and I didn't feel I didn't feel right throwing one away, so I put two on. Sometimes I'll put on three. If they come in, sometimes they'll come in doubles. You'll see two together, and so well, it's too hard to cut them out separately. So just cut them out together and make a nice wide spot for them, and then press the top in gently so that it seals against the top and it's not going to fall to the bottom, because those queen cells really should be incubated for a little while longer. The pupa inside is still pupating. Metamorphizing. She's not eating anything. She's in the metamorphosis process. Everybody knows butterflies, metamorphosis. Same thing for this queen. She's in there pupating and becoming an adult, and she's not eating anything, but she still needs to be maintained at a good temperature. 97 is the right temperature. So if you don't have a nuc and you can't make a nuc real quickly, but you still want to save that queen cell, take it and put it in your honey heater at 97 degrees, and she'll hatch. In a couple of days, you'll have a virgin queen in your honey heater or in a chicken incubator, 97 degrees. And if you can buy the little capped hair rollers, they call them, to put the queen cell in, she'll be captive in that little plastic device. And you can then take that virgin queen and put her in with some nurse bees, and they can feed her until you're ready to make the nuc a few days later. And don't waste those queen cells. They're too valuable. That's my advice. Queen castles, real quickly. Yes, I'm sorry.
This is probably a really silly question.
No.
But, so is it safe for the bees just to take off the queen cell, or just push it off? Or how would you take it off to reposition it and not hurt the...
Pocket knife. Okay. I take a pocket knife and I very carefully excavate around it. And sometimes when you're excavating that queen cell, if it's attached to the bottom, the frame at the bottom where the wood is or the plastic is, when you take it off, even though you're being very careful, when you take it away, you'll look on the back side and there's a hole in the back and you can see the queen larva in there. It's kind of just moving back and forth. If she's pretty much adult, she's almost finished, she's pretty big and she's still wiggling just a little bit. She's maybe moving a little bit. And you can take a little piece of wax and just cover up that hole and then put it in there. But just be very careful. But don't be afraid. Just do it. Yeah.
So, Joe, when you put the queen cell into the, embedded into the new comb, what do you do? Just gently pinch the edge?
At the very top, I will pinch just a little bit of wax into the top to hold that queen cell in position. I try not to touch the queen cell in any other place. And I only use medical gloves, and I never touch the queen cell with my bare hands. I only use medical gloves to move those around and get them in there quickly. On the other hand, they're not that sensitive or critical. For example, last night I was in a beehive. There was a big storm coming. Was that last night?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I knew there was a place I needed to go. I knew there were a whole bunch of queen cells that needed to be harvested. I said, this is not a good time, but I did it anyway. And I got there, I used five or six of the queen cells making nukes, and I still had two left over. And I said, I'll take them home and put them in the honey heater at 97 degrees. And when I got home, I forgot. This morning, I got up, they were sitting on the counter there next to the stove. It was about 65 degrees all night long, and I looked in there, and that larva, that pupa, was still moving. So 65 degrees overnight, it didn't kill her. So I took her and put her in the honey heater, and I think those will hatch. So they're not that critical, but 97 degrees is the right temperature, if at all possible, keep them warm. And if you're moving queen cells, for example, you need to send a queen cell to somebody who has a drone-laying colony where you're going to use, that's the best thing to requeen a drone-laying colony is use a queen cell. That's the very best. Queens, don't even bother. You're throwing your money away. Use a queen cell. But if you need to transport one, get yourself a cooler and find a brick, heat it up in the oven, and then put it in the cooler, and then you can transport your queen cell in some cotton and keep it at a nice warm temperature. So transporting queen cells is really easy. All you need is a six-pack. There was one more thing, and that was that queen castles do work, but I don't recommend them because the queens will hatch and communicate with one another, and the bees will think that they've got a queen, and they'll kill what's on the other side of the barrier. So I've used these for years. I've failed for years. If anybody wants to buy some queen castles, I have a whole bunch for sale really cheap. So why else to make nukes? Because they're worth a lot of money. Better Bee sells them every year for $175, and they're sold out in February every year. So I thank you for your attention. This has been about beekeeping 357, doing the three essentials. That is, control varroa mites, requeen, feed your bees if necessary, and make splits using the 3, 5, and 7 method of in May. June and July. And when you get a chance, be sure and go to Beekeeper's Corner podcast and listen to a podcast. If you drive to work and you listen to the radio, you're wasting your time. You need to listen to Kevin England on Beekeeper's Corner podcast or one of the other great beekeeping podcasts. Kevin is also the president of Northwest New Jersey Beekeepers. And if you want to see more of my material and articles, go to the Susquehanna Beekeepers website and read my articles. I appreciate your patience, and I thank you for your time. It's been very enjoyable to be with you. Thank you.